That's right. I'm just doing so. Good morning, everyone. And beyond the board members, I'd like to welcome everybody to August meeting of the University of Wisconsin System Board of Regents. The chair is thoroughly confused because Regents have moved to different spots around the table. Figure out. So, Betty, if I turn to you and call on Regent Spector, you'll just forgive me. That's right. Would the secretary please read the roll?
Regent Bartel. Regent Bradley.
Here.
Regent Burmaster.
Here.
Regent Connolly Kiesler.
Here.
Regent Crane.
Here.
Regent Keene.
Here.
Regent Davis.
Here.
Regent Drew.
Here.
Regent Falbo.
Here.
Regent Loftus. Regent Opkinor.
Here.
Regent Pruitt.
Here.
Regent Smith.
Here.
Regent Spector.
Here.
Regent Thomas.
Here.
Regent Vasquez.
Here.
Regent Walsh.
Here.
Regent Womack.
Here.
A quorum is present.
Here.
Thank you. This morning we're going to focus our attention on the 2009-2011 biennial budget. You all know that Chapter 36 gives us the responsibility to determine for the state or make a recommendation to the state for the needs for higher education in the state of Wisconsin. And we do that in the form of our operating budget and our capital budget. I think how we put the budget together and also how we explain it, how we talk about it, is very important. And I think you'll hear from Kevin and others that we are being responsive not only to the governor's budget directions, but we are also being responsive through our teaching, our research, and our public service on our campuses and through extension in being the solution for the state of Wisconsin's needs to be a prosperous state. So with that, I would like to introduce President Riley to begin the discussion.
Thank you, President Bradley. Good to see you and the rest of the board members for what I guess is our, and the chancellors and provosts and other guests, for what I guess is our inaugural meeting of the 08-09 academic year, which seems unfair given that the August weather is still so nice, but we are starting a new academic year and here we are. We'll be talking budget very soon, as Mark indicated, but first I wanted to introduce a few very talented people who are here with us today, all of whom are taking on new leadership roles in the UW system. First up, coming back home to Wisconsin after spending some time in the Lone Star State is Dr. Tom Andrews, who's probably back here, Tom. He's our new UW system senior VP for Administration and Fiscal Affairs. Tom, who is a Racine native, was most recently senior VP for Administration and Finance at Texas Tech University, where he's been since 2004. Before that, he was Senior Vice Chancellor for Finance and Administration at the Oregon University System and has previously held leadership positions in the Nevada System and the Connecticut System. So I do have to tell you that Tom admits he's a Bears fan, but we'll try not to hold that against him. Some folks from that southeastern part of the state kind of slip across the line, you know, towards Chicago sometime. Welcome, Tom. Also returning. Also returning to familiar turf is Dr. Biddy Martin, the new chancellor at UW-Madison. Biddy's over here. Stepping in as John, who's sitting next to her, steps out. Biddy earned her doctorate in German literature right here in Madison, so she should at least have a head start on finding her way around on campus, although in the last week, Biddy, with the move-in, move-out, and construction going on, I don't know that anybody can find their way around on the Madison campus very easily. Biddy spent 8 years as provost at Cornell University, and prior to becoming Cornell's provost, she spent 4 years as senior associate dean in Cornell's College of Arts and Sciences. A professor of German studies and women's studies, she's also served as the chair of Cornell's German Studies Department. So welcome, Biddy. Glad to have you with us. After serving on an interim basis for the past year, Dr. Dick Telfer is now officially the 15th chancellor at UW-Whitewater. Dick started his career at Whitewater 20 years ago, more than 20 years ago, as a faculty member in the College of Education. And before taking on the chancellorship, he held the position, as you know, as provost at UW-Whitewater, and that job for 5 years. So congratulations, Dick. To the northeast, we have Dr. David J. Ward, who has set aside his model railroading hobby to step up and serve as the interim chancellor at UW-Green Bay. Welcome, David. David's a familiar face to people here at UW system and in Green Bay. He was born and raised in Green Bay, and UW-GB is not only where David started as a student, but it's also where he began his academic career. David has a 31-year involvement with UW system, including 6 years as the senior vice president for academic affairs with the UW system administration. He's also the president of North Star Economics, a private economic consulting and research firm, which has done wonderful work on the knowledge economy with campuses and businesses and communities around the state. So we welcome David back for a little while anyway. Now moving from the northeast to the southeast, Dr. Lane Earns will be serving as interim chancellor at UW Parkside. Lane's back. Up the reins there for retiring Chancellor Jack Keating. Lane has spent the last 21 years at UW Oshkosh, serving most recently there as the provost and vice chancellor for academic affairs. A strong advocate for the growth agenda, Lane will be leading a campus at UW Parkside that boasts the most diverse student body in the UW system, and like UW Oshkosh, shares a common focus on the success of first-generation college students. So congratulations to Lane. Finally, in completing our tour of the state of Wisconsin, coming to the UW system from our neighboring state to the west, is Dr. Kathleen Enns Finken, the new provost and vice chancellor for academic affairs at UW La Crosse. Kathleen. Kathleen served previously as the dean of the College of Arts and Humanities at Minnesota State University in Moorhead, Minnesota. Before that is, she was wooed away by Chancellor Joe Gao and the UW La Crosse community. Although she is not a poker player, she said it was something about the bluffs. Welcome, Kathleen. Well, we better switch to the subject of budget now. And budget is about money, finally, how you get it and how you spend it. So, President Bradley, I thought I'd begin our discussion of money by reciting a poem entitled Money. It's a poem by Dana Gioia, who is the chair, besides being a poet, and a well-regarded one, is the chair of the National Endowment for the Arts. So who says that administration, at least arts administration and poetry, don't mix? He starts his poem with an epigraph from Wallace Stevens, an even better known American poet who happened to be an insurance executive in Connecticut. So who says business administration and poetry can't mix? The epigraph from Stevens is, money is a kind of poetry. And here's the poem. Money, the long green, cash, stash, rhino, jack, or just plain dough. Chalk it up, fork it over, shell it out. Watch it burn holes through pockets. To be made of it. To have it to burn. Greenbacks, double eagles, megabucks, and Ginny Mays. It greases the palm, feathers a nest, holds heads above water, makes both ends meet. Money breeds money, gathering interest, compounding daily, always in circulation. Money, you don't know where it's been, but you put it where your mouth is, and it talks. So I would say my role today is to convince you that our 09-11 biennial budget proposals, both the operating and capital sides, put our money where our growth agenda mouth has been for the last several years and make it talk on behalf of our students and all our other stakeholders of the University of Wisconsin. Let me take a brief step back to help frame the larger budget process in our discussions going about the budget for the next biennium today. As you recall, at your June meeting in Milwaukee, I shared with you a preliminary preview of the UW System's biennial budget proposal. That sneak preview was meant to be an early discussion and begin our process of budget review with this board. Following that meeting, the June meeting in Milwaukee, each region was provided the opportunity to receive a briefing from system administration, budget and finance staff to provide further information and bring some issues and questions the regents might have to the fore in the course of those small conversations. The board's capital planning and budget committee, chaired by Regent Jeff Bartel, also convened a special meeting on July 31st, to which all the regents were invited, to provide that committee, its members, with an additional opportunity to review what is admittedly a very complex capital budget. So after a full and open discussion this morning, you'll have a chance to sleep on it. And then tomorrow, after perhaps some more good discussion, you'll be asked to vote on the UW System biennial budget for 2009-11. Following your actions tomorrow, a formal operating budget request will be submitted to the Department of Administration in September next month. And you'll see the flow of the operating budget on the left-hand side of the slide after you approve it, presuming you do. The statutes in the state require that we submit this operating budget by September 15th. DOA will consider our agency request for inclusion in whole or in part then in the governor's executive budget bill, which will likely be introduced in February. The Joint Finance Committee will begin legislative deliberations in the spring of 2009, and you can follow along down that ladder on the left as I'm talking. The Joint Finance Committee beginning the legislative side deliberations in spring, with the Assembly and Senate deliberations to follow during the summer months. After reviewing the legislature's final budget bill and announcing any partial vetoes, the governor will sign a 2009-11 state bill into law. With that said, the new two-year state budget bill will be completed, we hope, a year from now, recent precedent notwithstanding. The capital budget side, on the right-hand side of the slide, the budget we hope you will approve tomorrow will be submitted to DOA's Division of State Facilities, the Division of State Facilities being a part of the Department of Administration, by September 8th per the request we received from DOA. That office, State Facilities, will review our request and forward its recommendation on to the State Building Commission in March of 2009. The Building Commission, which is chaired by the governor and comprised of six legislators and a citizen member, will review DOA's recommendations and then recommend a state capital budget to the Legislative Joint Finance Committee. The Joint Finance Committee will hold deliberations on the state's capital budget, the overall state's capital budget, as part of the 09-11 biennial state budget process. And action by the Joint Finance Committee is then considered again by the Assembly, the full Assembly and Senate, and then is finally sent to the governor for his approval and or partial vetoes. So that, you will be delighted to hear, concludes my lecture on how a bill becomes law. With that larger framework laid out, let me begin by talking about our proposed operating budget. We'll do the operating budget first and then move to the capital budget. The 09-11 biennial budget request I'm recommending to you is a continuation of the growth agenda for Wisconsin, which I first introduced to this board in February of 2006. During the last state budget, the growth agenda received very broad public support and bipartisan legislative support because individual initiatives in it were developed locally with the personal involvement of business leaders and regional economic development entities, students, community leaders, local elected officials, and others. Those local stakeholders understand that this is not about building a bigger university. It's about building a vibrant state where our children and grandchildren can enjoy a high quality of life. You have some more letters reflecting that sentiment from business leaders and other groups that I mentioned in your packets this morning. The chancellors have begun out across the state to solicit that kind of support for our 09-11 budget, and once you pass it, we will ramp up that that process even further. The growth agenda for 09-11 includes three strategic goals, which you see on the slide in front of you, that reflect broad consensus: growing people, growing jobs, and growing communities. Under this strategic framework, the UW system will seek to produce more baccalaureate degree holders, to create more seats in our classrooms, to enroll more working adult students, to help prepare more young people for college, and to expand transfer opportunities, all the while with a strong emphasis on keeping college affordable for Wisconsin students and families. We'll strive to create more well-paying jobs, as the second goal there says, by addressing business needs, developing online accelerated and collaborative programs to meet regional objectives, and transforming research at a greater pace into leading-edge, knowledge-based jobs. And we'll look to grow our communities by engaging with them to connect university learning and resources directly to their priorities, and by increasing access to education for all Wisconsin citizens. So our request for new initiatives in the 09-11 operating budget seeks $51 million of ongoing funding to support the growth agenda. And you'll see that 50.9 figure on the right-hand side, right under the total, top of the total column. That divides into $37.5 million in additional state general purpose revenue and $13.4 million in fees. Those numbers are up there as well. Last biennium, if you want to skip down to the bottom of the slide, just to give you a basis for comparison, the Regents requested $40.9 million to support the growth agenda, and that was divided, as the slide shows there, between 27.3 in GPR and 13.6 in fees. In putting this request together, I want the Regents to understand that we've looked very carefully at ideas that came forward, the chancellors and staff assistant provost, business officers on the campuses, and others all worked together, recognizing the economic realities facing the state. And this growth agenda that you see before you, these numbers and the proposals that are described in the region packets from each of the institutions, they have been reduced by one-third from what was originally submitted by the campuses. So we have not simply taken what's come over the transom from each of the institutions and put it forward as our package. We've worked through across the campuses and institutions as colleagues to try to make this as cost-efficient a package as we can have while still advancing the goals of the growth agenda. And one of the interesting things that happened through the budget repair bill that was recently passed was people on both sides of the aisle, people from all walks of life across the state, said to us, "We want you to continue with the growth agenda. Whatever happens with the budget and the budget repair bill, we don't want you to stop the growth agenda." This request includes plans to provide additional access to more than 7,000 students, along with other initiatives focused on enhancing the state's workforce and stimulating economic development. Additional state investment will also be needed to sustain the UW system's current academic operations, to cover increased utility costs and other normal inflationary factors. And that's the cost to continue line that you see up there on this slide. In total, the 09-11 biennial budget request, including costs to continue those funds needed to sustain our current level of quality and success, will be quite similar, finally, to the 07-09 request if you pass it in the way we're proposing it. This 09-11 request totals $124.1 million of ongoing resources, $87.8 million of GPR and $36.3 of fees. Again, you see that in the third line down on the slide. And 07-09, dropping again to the bottom of the slide just for comparison purposes, this board requested $120.1 million divided between GPR and fees, as you see. So those two figures, the 124.1 on the top and the 120.1 on the bottom, are fairly similar kinds of asks. I know that we're all interested, all of us, in the impact this request might have on tuition increases in the coming biennium. I'm pleased to report that tuition rate increases are also expected to be similar to 07-09, when they were the lowest in 6 years. That is between 5% and 6% a year, except at the UW colleges, which had no tuition increases. You recall, we froze the tuition at the colleges, and I'm proposing that we do that again in 09-11. The fact that we're projecting similar tuition rate increases for the upcoming biennium should not come as any surprise then, given that the total of $124.1 million of GPR and fees that we're requesting for 09-11 is about the same as what we asked for 2 years ago. I'd like to remind you and others here that we're not being asked to set tuition today. We are not setting tuition today. And that there are a number of factors and variables, such as inflation on utilities and possible gubernatorial and legislative adds to our budget, changes to our budget request. There are pay plan increases, I'll come back to that, veterans remissions issues that will ultimately impact what that actual tuition amount will be. But taking into consideration all those variables and knowing that they are variables now and we don't know what the real numbers will be, and we won't for a while, we still, our best estimate is we still should be able to, and we still want to be able to hold that tuition increase to about the same range it was last year, between 5% and 6%. A very significant factor then, which is not included in this budget today, is pay plan. That's because pay plan and the way the state operates is handled differently, separately from both our operating and our capital budgets. Compensation for faculty and academic staff, as I think this board knows, remains a very major challenge for us in the University of Wisconsin. Our faculty salaries are now about 10% lower than the average at our peer institutions. We've seen, you've all seen certainly considerable local and national media coverage on these challenges that UW institutions face in recruiting and retaining talented faculty. The pay plan increases this biennium have not helped us close the gap. As a matter of fact, they've had quite the opposite effect. You remember they are, the pay plan increases in this biennium set at 2% this in July 2007, 1% in July 2008, and 2% to come in July 2009. A pay plan request for the UW system is typically submitted after this board approves it to the Office of State Employment Relations, OSER, in December. So that's coming up before us. That office will consider our request and forward their recommendations to the legislature's Joint Committee on Employment Relations. So your recommendation, presumably in December on pay plan, will go to the Executive Office of State Employment Relations. They will consider it and then pass it on in some form to the Legislative Joint Committee on Employment Relations, or JOCER as it's known. And that committee will then review and either approve the pay plan that comes out of OSER, or if they don't want to approve it and want changes, they will send it back. And our ask will be part of the larger ask for state employees generally. Both houses of the legislature and the governor then have to approve a new state pay plan before it can take effect. So we're not doing that today. But in addition to our own budget request today on the operating side, we are looking carefully at the investment needed in other agencies that relates to our business in the University of Wisconsin. One notable area we're watching closely is on veterans remissions. Again, I'll remind you, this board at your June meeting passed a resolution requesting that the Higher Education AIDS Board, and by the way, Regent Jeff Bartel has just been appointed to the Higher Education AIDS Board, representing the Regents, and we congratulate him on that appointment. The Board of Regents passed a resolution requesting that HEAB, the Higher Education AIDS Board, in their 2009-11 budget include a request for additional state support for veterans' tuition remissions. We're also studying the potential impact of a new federal law on our state veterans' support. You may be familiar with the fact that the feds did pass a new GI bill that was sponsored by Senator Webb out of Virginia. That bill will not take effect, however, until August of 2009, so a year from now. And it is targeted specifically on those who joined the armed forces post 9/11. We think that bill will certainly help hold down cost increases in the state program, but it won't have any effect in 08-09 because it won't take effect until August of 09. It is different from our state program in the sense that our state program, veterans who were in the armed forces before 9/11 are also eligible. Lots of varying provisions between the local Wisconsin program and the federal program that are going to have to be reconciled in some way. We're analyzing those differences now. When Mark and I met with legislators a week ago, we gave them a heads up on this and said we may well feel we need to come back to you with some suggestions for reconciling the state program with the federal program so that Wisconsin veterans can take maximum benefit from the federal program and then use the Wisconsin program as well to fill in where that federal bill won't cover. So at any rate, lots of work to be done there. And by the way, although it's too early to tell finally what the impact will be, I will have a column on this topic in Trusteeship Magazine in the September issue on the veterans, both our state and the federal program, so we'll get that around to folks when that gets published. Second issue we're watching closely that goes in another agency's budget, again, HEAB, not our budget, is financial aid generally. You passed a resolution, I'll remind you again, at your June meeting in Milwaukee requesting that HEAB include a request for additional state support to increase financial aid for UW system students by at least the same dollar increase in resident as the resident undergraduate tuition increase. So we're looking for HEAB, we were looking for HEAB to really put forward a dollar for dollar hold harmless increase for University of Wisconsin students. That's obviously very important to us to preserve access to all students who wish to pursue a college degree with us, regardless of their family's financial or their own financial situation. So I'm very pleased to say that at its August 8th meeting, the HEAB Board of Directors approved the inclusion of our request for financial aid and veterans remission reimbursement in its budget request to the state, and we're hopeful that the governor and the legislature will fully fund now that HEAB request, and we will be helping them lobby for those provisions in their budget. We enter this budget cycle, I wanted to remind you too, with some what I'll call lingering financial hangovers from the biennium we're in. The UW system absorbed $50 million in lapses during the 07-09 biennium, including $25 million each from the original 07-09 biennial budget bill, and then that second $25 from the biennial budget repair bill that we just went through. And the 07-09 biennial budget calls for another $25 million in lapses in 09-11. So that will be a total of $75 million in lapses over the two biennia, assuming that that $25 million lapse in 09-11 actually happens. Part of the good news here is that the governor's stated priorities for Wisconsin include access to higher education for all Wisconsin citizens and the implementation of initiatives that will help grow and support high-skill, high-wage employment in the state. And so the governor's budget directions for preparation of our budget in 09-11 for state agencies generally, interestingly, asked state agencies not to submit requests for any additional GPR. But in recognition of the UW system as a major engine of economic growth for the state, the budget instructions from the governor included a specific exemption that allows the UW system to submit initiatives for instruction and research activities focused on economic growth. The governor's priorities and budget instructions then aligned very well with our growth agenda for Wisconsin, and we were also in to see the governor about this, Mark and Chuck and I, as well as the legislators, so he would be aware of what we were going to be talking with you about today. Finally, on the operating budget side, there's included in our request $70.2 million of program revenue authority. And program revenue includes things such as gift and trust funds, room and dining charges, parking, segregated fees. Again, like the tuition issue that I just mentioned, the board is not being asked to set rates or fee levels in any of those areas today. We're asking simply for a projected amount of authority to have the ability to spend. The board will actually tackle that task of setting rates in these areas next summer when you approve our annual budget, as you did in the June meeting for this year. So those fees actually get set on an annual basis. So with that review, I'm going to turn the session over now to Associate Vice President Frieda Harris and ask her to highlight the major provisions in the 09-11 operating annual budget. Frieda.
Good morning, and thank you, President Riley. The biennial operating budget proposal that we're asking you to consider today consists of five parts: new initiatives, cost to continue, program revenue, statutory language change requests, and performance measures. The budget complies with the governor's and DOA's 2009-11 budget instructions. As President Riley mentioned, most state agencies were told to not submit requests for new GPR funding in 2009-11. There was an exception provided for cost to continue items, which are negotiated with DOA, and exemptions were also provided for certain other programs, including UW system instruction and research activities focused on economic growth. The budget instructions also required state agencies, including the UW system, to prepare a plan for a 10% base reduction, which is due in November. The UW's plan will be based on 10% of its administrative activities. A similar report has often been required in the past. We will begin working on that plan and will bring it to you for your consideration later this fall. The new initiatives, the first component of the budget, are based on the growth agenda and incorporate the action steps that were developed this year. The institutional initiatives are divided into categories tied to the goals of growing baccalaureate degrees, jobs, and communities. The initiatives at the UW colleges and UW Extension, UW Green Bay, UW La Crosse, UW Oshkosh, UW Parkside, UW Superior, and UW Whitewater are all primarily targeted towards increasing access and baccalaureate degrees. These initiatives will provide access for approximately 5,900 additional students, 4,500 of whom would be online. They would also increase graduation rates through improved retention. When we combine the Grow Baccalaureate Degrees initiatives with the Growing Jobs initiatives, access would be provided for more than 7,000 additional students. UW-Madison, UW-Milwaukee, UW-Platteville, UW-Stevens Point, and UW-Stout are primarily focused on growing jobs through improved graduate education, increased external funding to the state, establishment of new schools and research targeted towards the knowledge-based economy, expansion of collaborative engineering programs, and access for more than 1,200 additional students. UW Eau Claire and UW Platteville have developed initiatives focused on growing the community by addressing the state's needs for additional applied behavior analysts who will work with people with autism and other developmental disabilities, and by developing a portal to match scholarly resources with civic, nonprofit, business, and community needs. The 2009-11 new initiatives request totals $51 million and includes $13.4 million to grow the number of baccalaureate degrees, $20.1 million for growing jobs, $1.5 million for growing communities, $10 million of funding to continue efforts to recruit and retain faculty, research, and instructional staff in areas where we are out of alignment with the market and to retain staff who are being sought by other institutions, and $6 million for increasing library resources throughout the system. Those library resources are not only critical for quality educational programs, they are also an essential tool for seeking and receiving grants, recruiting faculty and staff, and expanding student participation in research. The second component of the operating budget request is cost to continue. Cost to continue funding is requested to maintain current operations. This funding does not allow you to develop new programming or add enrollment. This budget request includes $73.1 million in GPR fee funding for cost to continue on an ongoing basis. Cost to continue items were an exception to the 0% GPR growth in the budget instructions, and most state agencies will have similar categories. The largest cost to continue items are $24.4 million for full funding of the June 2008 pay plan increases of 2%. The 2007-09 budget included funding for only 1 month of that increase, and the other 11 months of funding will be needed during the 2009-11 biennium. This initiative will provide that funding and add it to the base. $19.2 million of funding is needed for DOA-approved fringe benefit rate increases. This initiative provides funding to reflect the changes in fringe benefits from the 2007-09 rates to the 2009-11 rates. The primary cost driver here is the change in the cost of health insurance. $10.6 million was requested to cover the $10.6 million was requested to cover the GPR fee costs of utilities associated with new space that will come online in the 09-11 biennium. This does not include an inflationary adjustment for utilities that will be added by DOA in the governor's budget. $6.4 million is estimated as the cost to cover classified increases above the general wage adjustments in the Joint Committee on Employment Relations approved pay plan for 2007-09. And $5.1 million is requested to cover the cost of maintaining new square footage that will come online in 2009-11. This request is needed in order for us to fulfill our responsibility of being good stewards of state resources. And it would cover the cost to do routine maintenance and provide custodial support for new facilities. The third component of the budget request includes increases to the authorized level in the budget for program revenue or self-supporting operations. They include $27.4 million for anticipated increases in gift funds, $23 million for auxiliary operations, $18.6 million for Madison Intercollegiate Athletics, and $1.2 million for trust funds. The total program revenue requested is $70.2 million ongoing. The fourth component of the operating budget request is statutory language change requests. The budget includes 8 recommended statutory language changes and 3 requested technical changes. 7 of the requests have been submitted by the board before. 4, however, are new this biennium, and they are a request to eliminate the $12,000 statutory cap on dual employment with another state agency or institution, a request to eliminate reports on excess expenditures for auxiliaries and operating receipts, a request to move the reporting threshold for reporting major expenditures to the same level as the major capital expenditures level, and a request to allow UW System to increase its use of minority businesses. The fifth and final component of the operating budget request is performance measures. The UW System has 4 performance measures that must be reported to the state as part of the biennial budget. Those consist of enrollment plans, retention to the second year, graduation rate within 6 years of matriculation, and contribution to the state of Wisconsin's economy. These 4 performance measures are cornerstones of the growth agenda for the state of Wisconsin. The UW System, as you are aware, has been working on developing new accountability measures for achieving excellence that will reflect the goals of the growth agenda. The goals that have previously been used in the performance measures have, in some cases, already been achieved or exceeded. We felt that it was important to take the time to review those goals to ensure that they fit with the new approach to achieving excellence and the growth agenda prior to submitting them to you and the state for approval. That being the case, we'd like to bring the performance measures back to you at the October board meeting for your discussion and review. When submitted, the UW System budget includes requests for attached entities and boards. We expect to include funding requests for the State Lab of Hygiene, the Veterinary Diagnostic Lab, and the Wisconsin Environmental Education Board. Those requests are not included in your packet, since those will be approved by the boards of those organizations. That concludes my remarks. I'll turn you back over to President Riley.
Thank you, Frida. We have yet to talk about the capital budget, but why don't we stop here and see if Regents have questions regarding the operating budget. Regent Falbo. Let me comment on that. When I took a look at the results on those four performance measures, what happened was these were goals. The goals on those measures were set 6 years ago by mostly a different Board of Regents. On Frida, three of the four of those goals, we've already exceeded them. In fact, we took a look. The question then for us, I think, becomes how much higher do we want to push up the goals? And how do we bring them back to the board? And we haven't had time to consider that once we realized that we were actually ahead of the game on three of the four goals. Am I right?
That's correct.
And as you know, DOA will get this budget, as I said, in September. We will have time to bring those goals with more thought, working with the campuses, back to you in October and submit it to DOA so that they and the governor have ample time to consider those goals and the actual accomplishments that we've had so far before the governor has to submit his budget in February. So, we have the data. We could have brought it forward to you and shown you what we've had. And I can assure you, at least in three of the four, we were ahead of where we wanted to be. But the real discussion we haven't had a chance to have is where do we want to set the goals going forward? And we want to do that in an intelligent way in consultation with the chancellors and others on the campus. We need a little more time to do that. Well, you do know what you're funding in the sense that three of the goals are goals in the accountability report that you saw and approved in April. Sharon, is that the end of that? What we did was really what had been done 6 years ago, and DOA required that we have each agency have some broad performance goals, was to excerpt goals out of our accountability report. So there's nothing new or surprising, and you saw the accomplishments we've had in those accountability reports when you looked at the individual campus ones in April and the overall ones, the overall one in April as well for the entire system. So I just want to assure there are no surprises here. We're doing well on these goals. The question is, how much better do we say we want to do? And we can come back to you in October and have that discussion and get that material into DOA in time for thorough consideration by them and by you as the budget season goes forward. And again, the governor will not be coming out with his budget until February, so there'll be plenty of time to consider those between October and February. Rita, do you know those numbers for the actual for 0709?
The actual amount of funding that we received for the growth agenda?
That's the one. No. It's slide number four. There you go.
The funding was $36 million for the growth agenda. The cost to continue was higher than that, and I'd have to look up that number. But on an ongoing basis, we requested 40.9, but we got $36 million of funding for the growth agenda in 2009. I do have it. I just don't have it with me right now, and I can certainly get that for you.
But it's higher than 79 million.
It is higher than that amount, yes. The reason for that is that we received almost everything that we requested under cost to continue, and they added in inflation adjustments for utilities, and they also added in debt service.
Regent Loftus.
Three questions, and all of you want to have one on the assumptions that went into the veterans programs, and two on the lacrosse initiative, and the third, the wisdom of completely backloaded budget here. What are the assumptions that went into the veterans programs? You're assuming, what did you put in your request? That we would get full funding for the state program and ignored the possible federal program?
At this point, what we did was an estimate of what the increases would be in the veterans remissions program without any changes or any of the changes that are related to the federal program. And the reason for that is that it's a very complicated program, and no one's really sure of the exact impact of that at this point.
But did you assume that that would be GPR or that would be tuition?
It would be GPR is the assumption that we have.
Okay, so our tuition decision of our last meeting, that tuition level would stay, but the expenditure that was for that tuition increase would now go to GPR?
That would be in the future. For the 2008-09 year, the Veterans Remissions Program, the federal program, doesn't go into effect. It doesn't go into effect until August of 2009. So that 3% that you put in for tuition for veterans remissions is needed during the 2008-09 year. Going forward, we did not build that increase into our budget. We are not assuming that that increase is continuing. We will revise that based upon what we know later about the impact of the federal program and the amount of state funding that is brought forward. But that will be a decision that you will have to make based on the information that we have when we set tuition next year.
Okay, and then do we know how many of our students, veteran students, are pre-9/11?
We do not know how many of them at this point are pre-9/11 versus post-9/11, because it's a little complicated. Not only is it when they enrolled in the military, but they could be continuing in service after 9/11, and it also depends on the length of service that they have in the military, what those benefits are going to be that they're receiving. So we're working with the Department of Veterans Affairs to try to get the information that we need so that we can do those better estimates, but it's still a work in progress.
Okay. I go ahead.
Yeah, Tom, sure. Go ahead.
Maybe Chancellor Bauer. The request is for using the total $664,000 GPR for student financial aid. And I guess my question is, you have that $664,000 in your base, and it continues in the base for the cost to continue. You're going to take $439,000 of that money and add it to financial aid. Presumably, you're already using 225.
That's correct.
Okay, so the 439, what's that used for now?
The 439 was to be used to advance the lacrosse growth agenda. Because you've already approved the differential tuition that will allow them to move forward with that growth agenda, they'd like to take those dollars and then repurpose those for financial aid. But I can turn you over to the Chancellor so that he can tell you more about that.
That's actually a bit of unfinished business, because we initially had received some funds at 600, I don't know the exact number, in the current budget. We didn't need all that money because we actually got our differential tuition that you approved. So that money we'd like to use for financial aid. Rather remarkably, we did bring that by way of legislation to the legislature, and it got held up in some of the jockeying at the end of the session. So this is an attempt to do what we intended to do all along, which is to use all of that money for financial aid. We're in a rather interesting situation in that we don't need all of that money to do the hiring that we're doing because we're doing that with our tuition differential. So this is something that is left unfinished from the last session.
So you need legislative approval to use any,
yes,
any of this money?
Well, for purposes other than what it was enumerated, yeah.
Right. Okay. And then my last question, I guess, is we put everything in the second year of the biennium, the whole growth agenda, the whole future of the university in the second year. On the slide about how a bill becomes a law, you forgot two things, Kevin. One, the role played by alcohol. Second, though, is... second is the revenue projections that we're going to get, and then the second set of revenue projections we're going to get from the Fiscal Bureau, and they could be really dismal. And can you go through the reasoning why we put everything in the second year of the biennium?
Now, let me ask Frida to address that. We do have some reasons for that. Frida?
Yes. We try to balance our initiatives and the requests as much as possible. Most of the cost to continue is in the first year. So you already have cost increases that the state really is committed already to covering for the pay plan and the health insurance and all those things. By moving the new initiatives into the second year, that gives us the ability to kind of work better with the revenue flows that will actually be there. You'll have revenue in the first year, you'll have some increases in the second year, and so then the requests would be timed to match better with that. Another reason is the hiring of faculty and staff. Because of the delays in when we have information about what is actually going to be approved, it's very difficult for faculty, for the university system to move forward with hiring of faculty and staff for the upcoming new fiscal year. So we wouldn't find out what's in the budget until at least July of 2009. And if we had in there increases for program and staff, we really couldn't use that until the second semester. So for most purposes, we just push it back until the second year, and that way we'll know what we have to work with, and we can move forward with those programs.
And Go ahead, Frida.
Another thing is we've just received the growth agenda funding for the first part that we got in the 2008-09 year that will allow us to move forward with implementing those programs and then move into the second phase of the growth agenda. So those are some of the reasons why we're looking at the second year.
And is it fair to say, too, that backloading a lot of the activity into the second year provides us with a bit of a buffer against what happened last time where the budget wasn't passed on July 1 but extended well after that deadline and there was uncertainty about what was going to happen. So getting things started in the first year, when the first year becomes a lot less than a year because the budget hasn't been passed, makes things much more difficult and uncertain. You're generally much more reliable to get started with what you asked for in the second year, therefore, and provide you with some time to do the hiring in what's left of the first year if you do have a delay in the passage of the budget again.
Well, yeah, I don't know if you should plan a budget based on the assumption that the budget deadline will be missed. I don't think the other state agencies are doing that. But doesn't this move a tuition increase into the second year of the biennium of some magnitude?
It actually tends to balance the tuition increases. When we look at the split on tuition based on the way that we currently have it. We would average a little bit more than the 3% in the first year and a little bit less in the second year, so around the 3%. If we moved everything to the first year, you would see a lot of tuition increases in the first year and then a significant decrease in the second year. So it's more balanced to do it this way as well. But tuition impact.
Tom, regarding the revenue side of it, when Chuck and Kevin and I met with the governor a couple weeks ago, he said the bad news is I'm going to stick with my January revenue projections. And he said the good news is I'm going to stick with my January revenue projections. I mean, we don't have anything other than that.
Right.
Other questions on the operating budget from Regents? Regent Walsh.
On slide 15, would you put that on? I apologize, I missed what you said.
Which one?
15. The funding BOA approved fringe rates of 19.2 million.
Correct.
Say that was health only?
I said the biggest cost driver there is health insurance.
What else is it?
It includes some changes in the retirement benefits, which actually I think went down a little bit. So
is that a number that we've had in the past as part of the cost of continuing, that percentage of the total?
Actually, that was a much higher number in the last budget.
Yeah,
yeah, this is actually a smaller increase than we've had.
Okay, then turn to slide number 16, the next one. Auxiliary operations, is that dorms, et cetera? Is that what we're calling auxiliary here?
Right, these would be increases to room and board for food operations.
Gift funds, is that just a best guess?
The gift operations, we look at a historical trend of what we've had with gifts and then take into consideration what has been happening in the last year or so. And as you know, it hasn't been growing as fast. And so this is a smaller number than we normally would have brought forward as increases to gift funds.
It is an estimate. And then,
it is an estimate. All of these are.
Last year was 2 million more, or last.
Biennial.
Yeah, biennial. Why is that?
The gift funds?
No, the total 72 versus 70. I'm just curious why those numbers are different or how much of it's an estimate.
The auxiliary operations, I think, are pretty much where we've had.
No, I meant the total. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I'm just. The reason that the total is down is because our gift and our federal funds are not increasing at the same rates that they have been in the past. And, in fact, we don't have an increase in here on the federal funds side because we think we've accommodated that with the increases that we projected 2 years ago.
Where's the federal funds there?
We don't need an increase on the federal funds because when we did the estimate 2 years ago, what we built in was enough to accommodate the growth that we anticipate having over the next 2 years.
But I didn't even see the funds up there.
Yeah. We're not requesting an increase. Okay. And so we're leaving it at the same level as an estimate going forward.
Last question on athletics. Why is it 18.6? The total budget says around 80 million. What is that made up of?
The intercollegiate athletics request is an estimate of funding that they would like to have over the next 2 years, so it's an estimate as well. In the different football, the golf, University Ridge, a number of different things are composed in there. I really don't have the details on the Madison Intercollegiate Athletics, but you know. Chancellor Wiley, would you like to?
No, that's fine. I just
I was great in fumbling on that response. I like that. Okay. I have a detailed request of it. Yeah.
Just the number I don't recall.
Okay.
Regent Burmaster.
Just to follow up on the first question that Tom had. So you're saying you think that the tuition increase will be about the same. So if we do get HEAB and the federal veterans money, Is your plan that you will use the $18 million or whatever with the surcharge, will you be applying that to other things in the biennium, or are you planning to, would we be present that we could have a lower tuition?
Well, again, keep in mind that the one thing, there are many more variables regarding how the federal veterans program will interact with the state than there are sureties. The one thing we are sure about is the federal program will not kick in at all this year, okay?
But HEAB would?
Well, the HEAB request here is for 09-11, you know, for the next biennium. So we're going to have to see how that all works out. We just don't really know how that will work out. So we just need to take this next year, really, to figure that out. And we hope that we'll be able to keep it down to about that level, given the kind of interaction that we hope the two programs would have at the federal and state level. But there are so many unknowns that I'm really hesitant to, you know, to make any promises at this point. Regent Crane.
I just wanted to comment how much I learned by the contacts that were made to us about the research infrastructure. I learned a lot about the academic world of today, and I just wanted to express appreciation for that.
Appreciate that. We did. I hope the board feels that we did try to hear sentiment that you expressed in some previous years of these are such big, complex budgets on both sides. We really need some time to hear and hear again and talk with each other in small groups and talk with each other in big groups, talk with the staff, talk with campus leadership about this. And we did really try to structure it this time around so you would have an opportunity to do that. So we hope that this kind of structure will work for you. And one of the things I'll ask after we get through it is whether it has and what improvements we can make for the next go around as well.
I think Regent Crane was referring to her contacts with the librarians on the library resources. They are extremely organized. They're very thorough. And it is amazing. They put together a CD. They have a brochure. We could learn a lot from them about budget at their librarians.
But I also want to say that I did appreciate the opportunity to have the briefing from you also. That was very helpful.
Thank you. Yes, sir. Regent Pruitt.
Just quick question. Slide 15, just to, on the cost to continue, could you just break down what other factors account for the decline, about $6.1 million less in the cost to continue, as I read it,
The biggest cost drivers in the last budget for cost to continue were that the fringe benefit rates increased significantly more last biennium than they did this time. And we had a larger utilities request partially due to cogeneration costs. So that was one of the parts that was related to that. That was sort of counterbalanced by the addition of the maintenance for new space. So, you know, if we hadn't included that, the number would have been, there would have been a wider difference between those.
Let's go to Regent Spector, and we'll come back to him.
I just have a conceptual question. On the intercollegiate athletics slide, where the other stuff is, what are the gift funds, is my first quick question, then I have a follow-up question. What are the gift funds, for example, that comprise the $27 million? Are they gifts from individuals? Are they gifts from...
They're gifts from individuals, the gifts from foundations, the gifts from a number of different places.
And those are gifts to the university or components of it?
Those are gifts to the university, and we have a category of appropriations that falls under that gift category. So we do a historical look at those appropriations to see how they've changed. But then we also do a reality check by checking in with some of our larger institutions about how their gift funding is coming in now and whether we should make adjustments up or down. And in this case, we adjust it down somewhat.
My question is, if that's the case, why is the Department of Administration and the legislature involved in gift funds that someone like me has made to the university? Meaning it is not subject to the legislature and the department.
This is just a technical part of the budget. And so that's why we really don't spend, I think, a great deal of time working with you on this. What we are doing is trying to just adjust the level of the budget that the state has so that it reflects more what the university is expected to bring forward in the next couple of years. We have the ability to receive and to spend the gift funds without having the legislature's approval, but we want the budget to look like or more like what our actual budget will look like in those years. So these are just requests on the gift side and on the auxiliary side and the trust side, which are just technical. The intercollegiate athletics is different because we do not have the ability to spend intercollegiate athletic funds without the approval of the legislature.
I think part of it, Mike, is to an effort at transparency. That is, we don't want to be...
Disclosure that right, we have this amount of money.
Right. We don't want to be presenting a budget that seems to be hiding significant sources of revenue.
The implication, though, is something...
It's a fine line. Regent Loftus.
Yep.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'd like to ask a question about the this budget and the goal of increasing the secure graduation rate, and maybe specifically about Oshkosh can talk a little bit about decreasing the degree credits to graduation from 145 to 135 and how that might play in your plan to increase the six-year graduation rate, and maybe for the Regents' benefit, how the graduation rate or how the degree credits to degree are determined campus by campus.
Rick, do you want to address that?
Well, obviously, both those outcomes, you look at our course, we have like 8 or 9 specific outcome measures. Increasing time to degree, credits to degree, and increasing graduation rate. Those two are highly related. In our case, we have the amongst the comprehensive largest number of credits to degree in the system. So we've got to do something about that. We have, and there's a reason for that. We have a couple programs that are more or less 5-year programs by design, which made sense in the old days, so to speak, that are now being changed. And these are in our college of education. So that's how we'll accomplish that. And the faculty and the dean are working on that right now. And then, of course, that's directly related to how graduation rate gets calculated. If we're going to use the 6-year one, then we can come back and have a discussion about what these outcome measures should be. Hopefully, they're more aligned with the college portrait ones that talk about, you know, how many of your students are graduating, say, 6 years later from your institution, from another institution they transfer, still enrolled at your institution, and still enrolled at another institution. That's a national movement that we're part of that will give a better sense of holding ourselves accountable to those types of things in a fair way. Did that get at the kind of questions you're asking?
And perhaps you could... Well, first of all, I want to compliment Chancellor Wiley for his recent remarks on how the numbers have improved. And I think Chancellor Wiley, didn't the graduation rate at Madison is now just a little over 4 years?
4.17.
Mr. President, how are the credits to degree set?
Yeah, a couple of you addressed the kind of general aspects of your questions, Regent Loftus stuff. I mean, the credits to degree are set by faculty in the disciplines. And we undertook a project as a system quite a number of years ago to see how we might drive down what could be excess credits to degree that had gotten into the mix over time without damaging the quality of the degree programs we were offering. And at the time, David J. Ward was the Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs and was at System in the middle of that. And David can correct me if I'm wrong, but my recall of that was it involved at each campus a lot of work with the academic deans and departments to say, well, are all of these credits actually necessary? And where can we we trim and get just as good or a better effect. I think we've gone down, Sharon, if you're here, remind me, from an average of 145 credits to complete a baccalaureate to 134. So we've actually dropped, on average, across the system by 11 credits. And, of course, part of the goal there was to keep costs down for students and families and to open up additional slots for succeeding students by having students be able to move along a little more quickly. And I remember the debates at the time, there was talk about, well, are we talking about time to degree or credits to degree? And we wound up focusing on credits to degree as the measure we wanted to work on, because the time to degree can be so variable depending on whether you change your major, whether you have to drop out for a semester because a parent dies and you have to go take care of that. But the credits to degree is a little more empirical measure that you can show progress on. And we've shown really great progress on that, and it's a tribute, I think, to the faculty and academic administration across the campuses that we've been able to do that.
Do campuses charge an increased cost for the credits taken above the credits needed to graduate?
Frida,
we did change that.
There is an excess credit charge, a surcharge. If you are at 165 credits,
way up there,
165 or 30 above your requirement. So if your requirement is 120, if you go, you know, but it's the higher of those. So. Yeah.
Regent Bartel. Thank you. Any other questions regarding the operating budget? We will be moving on to the capital budget next. Yes, Regent Drew. Thoughts in response to that, Regent Drew. We are undertaking, in cooperation with the Office of State Employee Relations, a thoroughgoing analysis of of where the gaps are for both faculty and staff, and in some disciplines and some types of jobs they're greater than in others. We want to sort some of that out so we can share a set of facts that we both agree are the facts on salary issues, salary gaps across our workforce. And Regent Bradley will, I think, talk a little bit tomorrow about one of the topics for our November one-day meeting. And I'll say no more, but we'll have a chance to address some of that there before we have to look at the pay plan approval in the December meeting. But this is a huge issue for us. It's a huge issue for faculty and staff who are employed here now. It's a huge issue because of the demographics of the professoriate and many academic staff as well who will be retiring in the relatively near future. And we have to have an overall compensation package, not just salary, but salary, fringe benefits, and other aspects of compensation that's competitive for our folks now and for the kind of fierce competition we will be in with universities all over this country as the baby boomers start to age out of the academic workforce and we are competing for new, younger folks to come in. This look that we'll try to take it in November then will look both at the immediate problem we have and at the longer range demographic problem that we have. Other questions and reactions on the operating budget? Hearing none, thank you, Vice President Harris. Good job. We'll turn to our capital budget request now. Our 09-11 capital budget request accomplishes several goals based upon anticipated general fund support from the state. Our system request prioritizes institutional requests over the next three biennia. So in the capital budget, we look out farther than just the next biennium. We look out over three biennia in the future. It also seeks to establish manageable expectations for the timing of projects across the system to be recommended for state funding. And the enumerated capital projects will all be designed to maximize sustainability and energy efficiency, thereby providing long-term savings, we hope, for the university and the people of Wisconsin. As with the capital budget, we simply did not gather up every idea that came to us, although every idea that came to us from the institutions was a good one in its own right in many ways. I want this board to know we've cut the number of projects requesting state funding in half from what we received by prioritizing capital projects. And again, that is a difficult process, and I want to thank the chancellors and other leadership on the campuses for helping us work through that in a collegial way. Our system institutions requested approximately 60 major projects to be supported by general fund supported borrowing, totaling approximately $1.3 billion between 2009-11 and 2013-15, so looking out over those three biennia, $1.3 billion, 60 projects. Our six-year plan that we're presenting to you now, having worked through those initial requests, anticipates funding 30 projects, totaling $773 million. Our capital budget request for the next 2 years, 2009-11, looking now just at the biennium immediately ahead of us, seeks new general fund-supported borrowing for 12 major projects, totaling $139.7 million. And that's, if you look at the slide, it's in the column with the blue-purple heading of GFSB there, the 139.7. Those projects would also include $24 million of program revenue-supported borrowing. And that figure appears a little bit to the right of the 139.7. So these projects are mixes of different kinds of funding. It's part of what makes it so complicated. The budget also requests enumeration of 16 projects funded by non-state sources, $257 million in program revenue supported borrowing and $88.9 million in gift grant funds. And those figures are on the next line down in the chart, the slide that you're looking at now. There's also $97.4 million of general fund supported borrowing that was previously enumerated in 07-09 for three projects where the funds will become available in 2009. And you'll see that in the GFSB column, that 97.4 million for advanced enumerations. Those projects also include program revenue supported borrowing, totaling 27.8 million right over to the right from the 97.4. Our request also includes 130 million in state funded borrowing for the UW system share of all agency funds, looking down at the bottom of the slide, and those go toward maintenance, repair, and renovation for our facilities. Funding there of another $25 million of program revenue-supported borrowing will augment the state-funded borrowing for the all-agency funds. This request includes advanced enumeration of three new major projects totaling $233 million on this slide over in the far right total column. And that's combined general fund supported borrowing, gift and grant funds, and program revenue supported borrowing. Finally, you should be aware that there are existing enumerations in place from 07-09 of $78.6 million made up of general fund supported borrowing and program revenue supported borrowing. Recall here that advanced enumeration refers to the authorization in one biennium to issue bonds in a future biennium. So this allows for full planning and design to occur in one biennium. These things take time, with the assurance, though, that the funds will be available to get the project underway in the next biennium. So when you add the funding for all the new major projects together and look at the various sources of funding that supports these projects, you see that nearly two-thirds of the funds are derived from non-general fund revenues. Now, I was going to say those are the green and red slides, but they're trying to fool me again because they changed the colors. Program revenue and gift and grant funds make up the lion's share of our request. I mean, that's an important point, I think, for the board to understand. Program revenue and gift and grant funds make up the lion's share of our request. The general fund supported borrowing makes up just that 37% that you see on the right side of our request for new major projects. As I mentioned before, I want to emphasize again that we prioritize these capital projects. This request for state funding for capital projects represents about half of the number of projects requested by individual campuses, which I already mentioned, down from 60 down to 30. But it also represents a reduction of 75% in terms of the dollars requested across the project. So half in terms of the number of projects requested, but a 75% reduction in terms of the dollars requested. Again, we're trying to make this request as reasonable, as cost-efficient, and effective as we can in light of the economic times. So finally, I want to point out that the capital budget is an area where our decisions, what we forward on and what we succeed in getting approved, can have an immense and immediate positive impact on Wisconsin's economy. If you use the standard economic multiplier, our total UW system capital budget proposal would translate into $1.7 billion in economic impact statewide and more than 20,000 Wisconsin jobs. And that's good news for all of us. So with that as a framework on the capital budget, I want to turn the podium over to Associate Vice President David Miller to ask him to highlight some of the major provisions in the 09-11 capital request. David.
Thank you, President Riley. There's significant detail in your budget document about the source of funds for every project, the descriptions of every project, and so to your great relief, we won't be talking about that. I'd like to fly over the capital budget at about 35,000 feet, and if you want to parachute into any of those details, we can do that. This chart is one that you've probably seen before. It actually mirrors the national chart for the same data, which is the construction of university property by decade. And you can see the large buildup in the 1960s and 70s of about 65% of our total space is the context for the predicament that we're in today, which is all of that space was built for a 30 to 40 year lifespan and is in great need of replacement or renovation. However, it was built inexpensively and does not lend itself very well to remodeling for modern instruction. This chart is really the basis of the capital budget request, and it looks back over four biennia to see where the program has been to predict where we might be heading. And if you look at, I'll go to the bottom, near the bottom first, the total new GFSB, General Fund Supported Borrowing, for the biennium. Those bold numbers going across by biennium are totals for the entire state, not just the university, for the total state capital budget. So the university is about 65% to 70% of that over this time period. We can see a disturbing trend. It's been declining from a high of $445 million in 2003 down to this current biennium of $393 million. If we took, going down one row, if we took the $445 million that was the capital budget in 2003 and applied the construction industry inflation index, we would be seeing a capital budget for July 2009 of $605 million. However, recognizing that the legislature looks at the previous biennia to set its inflation looking forward and has not been going up, we are building a capital budget based on a total state request of $512 million, which is somewhere between where they are now and where inflation would take you. For major projects, back up at the very first row, for UW projects only, major projects, you can see a trend of growing amounts for major projects, resulting in $218 million in 07-09, this current biennium. However, if you follow 07-09 down to the all-agency fund that includes the university, that fund was reduced significantly from $200 million last biennium to only $125 million for all state agencies in 07-09. I'm pointing that out to draw a correlation between if the bottom line doesn't increase and you increase in one category, we suffered a loss in the other category. And we're really feeling that this biennium, and I'll come back to that in just a moment. So that's the justification for the basis of building this budget, predicting that we would like to have $140 million, as President Riley mentioned, for new major projects, and we'd like to see the state get its all-agency maintenance repair fund back up to $200 million, of which we would predict to receive about $130 million. President Riley mentioned the process and of requests that come into the university system, and we use a prioritization process. Long-range planning is the backbone of prioritization, and we did receive about $550 million of requests for new state-supported borrowing for major projects alone, and had to get that down to a predictable amount of about $140 million using Board of Regents approved priority criteria. Interesting, though, an in-depth analysis of the application of that criteria to the projects turned out that the number one most influencing criteria of all that we use was the institutional rank. Was it their number one priority? Then that pretty much determined where it would come in the priorities. So the institutions play a very big role in setting these priorities. We talk about very large numbers in the capital budget, and it can seem a bit overwhelming. But when we own and operate $56.5 million gross square feet, and we look at the gross square feet impacted by all of the projects in the 09-11 budget, we're only touching cumulatively through remodeling, new space, and demolition 2.1% of our square feet. That's about equivalent to remodeling the half bath in the average home. That's the capital budget impact on all of our space. And what we're really asking, what we're really asking for is, when we talk about large numbers, another way to bring some context to it is what we're really asking for from the state is the debt service on the bonds issued. So the debt service, predictably, would be about $28.8 million for major projects and maintenance combined, as a one-time base increase to our debt service appropriation for on 20-year bonds. That's what we're essentially asking for to support this entire budget. The program revenue, which are self-supporting bonds, the operations would generate the debt service for that, estimated to be about $24.5 million. And interestingly, all of the gift funds that are raised and expended on capital projects, particularly for academic administrative space, that is GPR-supported space, saves having to borrow that money. The $89 million included in gift funds would save $7 million a year for 20 years in debt service. Despite all the challenges that we talked about in the capital program, we are very proud, and the state is very proud, of two award-winning buildings and all the projects that have been accomplished over the last two biennia. But I highlight these two because I happen to have really good pictures of them. The UW River Falls Student Union, an award-winning design, is an example of how architecture breathes life into a campus. And I know that we had a Regent meeting there that many of you were at, and I heard comment after comment about how much you appreciated what that facility did for that campus. Likewise, the Microbial Sciences Building, another award-winning design, has been talked about at national conferences already as a great example of how architecture can foster great academic collaboration in a research facility. The budget contains a $10 million request for improving our funding for our 1,600 general assignment classrooms throughout the 13 universities. You'll recall that the college facilities are funded by the counties. So I'm talking here about the 13 university classrooms and just general assignment classrooms. We've had a 10-year, now 12-year program of investing money in classroom technology and minor remodeling. And we've seen significant improvement, but still 34% of those need technology improvements and 36% of those need remodeling. And, of course, there's some overlap between those categories. The improvement has come in upgrading 461 of those classrooms already in this program, and we've reduced our percentage of classrooms without core technology from 81% in 95 to 30%. Back to maintenance for a moment. I mentioned that loss of decrease of the increase of funding for maintenance has had a significant amount, an impact over the last three biennia. In 2003-05, we were able to fund about 70%, that's the green column in the middle, of institutions' request of their highest priority maintenance projects, the leaky roofs, leaking plumbing, those sorts of things. But due to the backlog growth of deferred maintenance and decreased funding in this biennium, we were only able to fund 22% of those. The backlog grows at an alarming rate. In 2007-09, we would have had to have spent $200 million to have just kept pace and not grown the backlog. So we're requesting $130 million going forward. Admittedly, that will grow the backlog, but within the scheme of the whole capital budget, it's an amount that would allow us to address the most critical needs that campuses have, but it would not chip away at the deferred maintenance backlog. And finally, in summary, as President Riley said, it's a long prioritization process. I described the amount requested within the state picture as aggressive but responsible. To be determined, some major issues going forward in the capital budget will be the financing of very expensive heating plant, power plant infrastructure that is looming, and developing ways to accelerate funding for deferred priority projects. That backlog is growing significantly as well. When we receive $550 million of campus priority requests for a biennia, and over two biennia can only address $250 million of that, the other $300 million are still there. They're just adding to the backlog that we need to address. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. Why don't you stay up there? Let's see if the Regents have questions or comments. Let me just say that I think before we go to the questions, that we're increasingly, those of us who work with this issue closely, are increasingly convinced that the process that we have now is not working now and won't work for the future, and that we are at a point where we've got to reinvent with the state a process that addresses how we bring forward our capital needs and gets them funded in some different new ways and at different rates. So that is something that with the Regent Bartels leadership we'll be working on over the next number of months with David and others, and hope at some point to be able to come back to you with some interesting ideas. We've begun to talk those over with chancellors and business officers and others in the system. So with that, Regent Fred Smith.
Certainly. We've talked about it at numerous chancellor's meetings, and we talked about it at length at the special meeting that Chairman Bartel called. There is not currently a requirement for any institution to bring GIP funds. However, clearly, if an institution brings a significant amount, and I can't define that, it isn't defined currently by the board or policy, that needs state funds as a match, that has to be a factor in the process. Particularly, there are no gifts that come without the contingency that you're going to lose the gift if you can't bring the state match. That's always a given. But currently, there's not a requirement. It is an open discussion that continued at the meeting, and Regent Bartel or other regents who were part of the committee or the discussion may want to talk about your thoughts, but it's an open question at this point. Correct.
Regent Bartel. Regent Loftus.
Yes, David. Thank you for the progress in a discussion of how fees might play into the funding of the capital budget. And if you wade through here, you can get a pretty good idea. The format I like is that you put fee impact at the bottom of the discussion, and then if there's non-zero, but if there is some delineated, can you talk about those projects that anticipate additional student fee supported borrowing, especially in the coming biennium?
The Eau Claire, excuse me, the La Crosse Residence Hall is a replacement residence hall for two old buildings that we are tearing down because of their condition and the need to put the new academic building on that site. And so they will be improved residence halls, and La Crosse is proposing to increase the rate by $397 to fund the construction of the additional 500 beds. So is that the kind of description?
Yeah, you're and for? If there are any anticipated student fees other than for residence halls that we're going to be asked for to support for as program revenue.
You mean associated with this particular residence hall?
No. This capital budget.
Oh, there are three projects that have segregated fees. Okay. If that's the ones you want to... Okay, I understand now. But there's not any. In UW-Platteville, the Williams Fieldhouse voted this past spring to start in 9-10 an annual fee increase of $70 to support the expansion of the Williams Fieldhouse. And that went through SUFAC. There are... I think that may be the only one in this package that has a set fee increase. And what isn't here is that there are three projects at three different campuses that will go through the student approval process yet this year. And so in discussions with those campuses, we did not want to bring those to you at this point, but bring them to the board in November or December after they go through the approval process, and then we can still submit them to the Department of Administration as a supplemental request before the first of the year. It's a process we followed for the last couple of biennia, having a supplemental request. But we thought it was better to have them complete that process rather than to bring them to you now contingent upon approval.
Yeah. Well, just to reiterate, it helps to have the fee impact mm-hmm. clearly delineated, so we know that. And a question for Kevin or someone. I assume there's no prohibition against using either fees or tuition for funding maintenance?
I don't know the answer to that question. David, do you?
Well, there... For capital projects, do you mean capital or do you mean operational maintenance?
Current your deferred maintenance.
For backlog.
So you wanted to accelerate.
There actually is a prohibition against that.
On both fees and tuition?
Yes. Tuition can't be used at all. For capital projects, there has to be a special statutory exemption for that, and UW-Platteville is the only campus that has that for non-resident tuition as part of Tri-State. The board policy, I think it's 90.3, outlines space by space what kind of dollars have to support that space. And if a project is built with seg fees will fund the maintenance for that, and we can't use GPR for that. But conversely, you can't use a seg fee for GPR maintenance either, or administrative space, so forth. The exception to that is, there's one exception in existence that I'm aware of. The board approved a modest increase for UW-Madison to use SEC fees for health services in the new University Square project back in 99-01.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? Yes, Regent Crane.
Jeff, is the system that is broken, is that seen as broken outside of the university system, and who else needs to be involved in your pursuit of remedies?
I think the system is broken, but the university has the largest part of the capital budget, state capital budget, so we are impacted the most by the dysfunction. And what's broken is that the statutory procedure and the procedures that are established by rule are not consistent with modern techniques of construction. I mean, it takes a decade in many cases or more to construct major projects. So as you budget for them, the budget is way off by the time you've designed it and costed it out. And so you have to go back and request expansions of the budget. And there are also procedures that are required for how these projects are constructed, what processes can be used to contract for these projects. All of that needs to be streamlined, needs to be cleaned up, and those are the items that
need to work. So who else needs to be involved outside of
that? Well, certainly the governor, certainly the legislature, certainly the building commission, certainly the Department of Administration. David has been working with David Helbach and others to identify the issues and try to come up with procedures. David, do you want to comment?
The building commission is keenly aware of needed improvements in the way state projects are designed, bid, and built. There's a waiver process an agency can go through to request a different method, and we were using that successfully for a while. In February, we requested that about 12 of our 40 projects have such a waiver because we thought it would be much more efficient, and through the political process, we received two of those. But that debate at the Building Commission fostered something good. The commission directed the Division of State Facilities Administrator and Building Commission Secretary to report back by November with recommended statutory changes to the process. And that is the process Regent Martell referred to that we're working through now, in which we all go in a room and negotiate, that hopefully something good will come out of. That is one side of the coin. We can improve delivery method processes the state uses and have some margin of efficiency gained. We strongly believe that. That efficiency gain will not produce a new revenue stream for you to attack this backlog of hundreds of millions of dollars of demand at the institutions as a result of government investment decades ago all at one time. That is a much harder thing to get a hold of.
Could I just add there, I think we have a kind of perfect storm brewing on this topic, I think, because we've got all of these buildings built, as David said, in the 60s, some of them in the 70s, that are reaching the end of their useful life. And right at a time when we are bringing more and more money in, all the chancellors working very hard to raise funds to help support the renovation and building of new buildings, and more of the people who are making those significant gifts are saying, when's the building going to start? I don't see anything happening with this money I gave to Gow or Wiley or Levin-Stankiewicz. What's the problem with you folks? And we're saying, well, you know, we've enumerated, and it might get started 20 years from now or so, and we hope you'll be patient, and they're not. And they're going to be a bigger and bigger part of our ability to keep our buildings in shape and to build new buildings. And the old process that we still labor under doesn't recognize any of that. John?
there are hundreds of problems with the way we build buildings and maintain them, but there are some very fundamental structural problems that in principle would be easy to address. For one thing, when you approve a project, you do it in public open session. You approve a project by name and by design and an amount. $50 million. Then we go to the building commission and they approve spending $50 million for this project. Then we go out for sealed bids. What do you think the bidders are going to bid? If you were going to do a project in your backyard, you wouldn't tell the potential bidders on your contract, I'd like to spend $100,000. How much will you do this for? That's what we do. Secondly, during over a period of decades when we had budget cuts, just about every time a budget cut was absorbed by state government in general, DOA's budget was in fact cut, like everybody else's, but DOA was given permission to recoup that loss by charging other state agencies for their services. They now tack on to
4%.
4% to every building project we have to cover their management of the project. That gives them no incentive to help us save money because the more we spend, the bigger their budget is. That's a structural problem. And it goes on from there.
Chancellor Wiley is right. And there are significant structural problems, and they are primarily statutory. And it requires actual statutory changes that makes it difficult. There's no flexibility. For example, last month at the Building Commission, we were meeting at State Fair Park, and fortunately the heated debate was not about a university project, but several other agencies having budget increases. The governor asked me how this worked with us, and I said, well, I'm going to be presenting a budget to the Board of Regents in 2 weeks, and there will be projects with actual budgeted numbers beside them. But these budgets are based on gross estimates of square feet of what we think that program might need, and then the gross dollars per square feet that we think in 4 years that space might actually cost. And most of that is built before there's ever an architect on the project to give you any of that design or cost estimating. So you end up with something called an increase that isn't really a budget increase. It's the first time you've ever actually had a budget. So there's no flexibility in there to actually take the predictable amount of bonding that you might have and do the very best you can with it to get the best projects. Because we do biennial budgets, it gets written into law that there's an amount for a budget, and it's just quite inflexible.
Regent Walsh.
It seems like every 4 years, governor's elections, we hear this discussion how we're going to change this, and we're 2 years away from that. The present governor certainly was one of the greatest critics, and I think he listened to John Wiley and others, the problem, the 4%. We forgot to talk about the 100-year-old buildings we're building that don't last 100 years, and why do we need a 100-year-old building? But the bottom line, and we shouldn't kid ourselves, is that we have a huge demand for buildings. And we will not have in the near future, the dynamic is not there, that will ever fund those buildings. Yes, we have an economy problem. Yes, we can create jobs and construction is good. And maybe DOA will give us a little leeway and allow us to bond a little more. But the problem isn't going to go away and politics isn't going to solve it. And yes, we might change the bidding problems and we might have a new legislature that maybe certain interest groups don't have the power they had before, but that's a small, small Band-Aid. The bigger problem in my mind is what you talk about, people who want to help, and they can't help because we can't build the buildings. The nursing school's got $13 million. That's a huge home run over the last 5 years, but it's too big a building to advance it. The only building that's ever made it here on gifts is the Granger building, where we waived everything because we had a full-funded building. We can't expect Platteville and Eau Claire to fully fund their buildings. The IRC Tower 2 has now got one half, $65 million in hand, and we'll get that one through. But the bottom line is we've got big battles ahead, and we've got to somehow figure out how to make the donors happy, and that, to me, is our best weapon.
Other questions or comments on the capital budget? Well, hearing none, I want to thank David and his colleagues and the people he worked with on our campuses. I want to thank Frida and her colleagues and the people they worked with on the campuses for doing just a very good job of a very difficult piece of work, putting this budget proposal together and then putting together the way we would communicate to you and to the wider public about it. So, Mr. President, I want to note that I'm turning this back over to you at approximately 11:55, and we're due to finish at noon, and that's pretty efficient timing, I
assume. If you don't think that Regent Connolly Kiesler took note of that, good. Well, get a good night's sleep tonight, because tomorrow we'll be debating resolutions on both the operating budget and the capital budget, and hopefully acting on those. Is there a motion to adjourn?
No.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.